You picked 12 outsiders nobody would have chosen and changed the world. The moral of the story is everybody's got a purpose.
Everybody's got a purpose.
So when I hear that devil start talking to me saying, who do you think you are? I say, I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul.
And I can't seem to win all these crazy thoughts and feelings. It's like it never ends until your voice breaks through my noise. I know I'm not alone, not alone. You fight my battles. If I would just be still, why would I keep running when you're here? I'll just be quiet. Let you speak through the silence. Here I am, no more hiding. You are in this moment, I won't fight it. I'll be quiet. I don't need to know what comes next. Tomorrow's in your hands, I can trust you with my future. Cause you're already there, I hear your voice. Pull me forward, and I know I'm not alone, not alone. Away with the distractions, I wanna hear what's true. The only words that matter, they come from you. I'll just be quiet and let you speak through the silence. Here I am, no more hiding. In this moment, I won't fight it. I'll be quiet. I'll just be quiet. Let you speak through the silence. Here I am, no more hiding. You are in this moment, I won't fight it. I'll be quiet.
Steady through emotions, I can be so up and down. I'm trying to find my focus when my mind is spinning round. Maybe I don't need to know how he's gonna work it out. Gotta put put my faith in him, trusting he's at work right now. If you know who I know, then you never ever had to chase what the world could give. Cause if you know who I know, then you never ever have to fear, cause he's on your side. So doesn't matter where I end up, as long as I am still with you. In every situation, God, you've always seen me through. Maybe what's impossible only seems that way.
How's everybody doing? Nice to meet everybody. This is a beautiful week we've had. We're looking forward to even a better week this week. If you do not mind, let's be upstanding as we are about to worship our King, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords.
He won't fail. is my song. I have a testimony.
Can I say my testimony?
Rain came, wind blew, my house was built on you. I am safe with you. I'm gonna make it.
Whose prayer is this? Come on.
Rain came, wind blew, my house was built on
this
you.
This is the reason we're standing.
I'm safe with you. I'm gonna make it through. Rain came, wind blew, my house was built on you. I'm safe with you. I'm gonna make it through.
I'm
gonna make it through.
Cause I'm
standing strong on you.
I'm
gonna make it through. Cause I'm standing strong on you.
Christ is my firm foundation,
the rock on which I stand, and everything around me is shaken.
Yeah.
I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus. He's never let me down. He's faithful through generations. So was built on you. I'm safe with you. I'm gonna make it through.
His name is Jesus. His name is Jesus.
Rain came, wind blew, my house was built on you.
He took my place on Calvary.
I'm safe with you. I'm standing strong on you. I'm gonna make it through. Cause I'm standing strong on you. I'm gonna make it through. Cause I'm standing strong on you. I'm gonna make it through. I'm standing strong on you.
Father, Rabbi, Savior, the King of all kings, the Lord of all lords, we stand on you. We trust in you. It's one thing that I want to remind us is that some trust in horses and chariot. Some trust in resources. Some trust in their income, some trust in their family system. But we trust, or we should trust, in the name of Jesus. We trust Jesus to hold our families together. We trust Jesus to hold our careers together. We trust Jesus to hold us in the tough times, to humble us in the high times, to strengthen us and endure in the enduring times. If you are standing on anything that is sandy foundation, anything that is weak foundation, anything that is not of God, the Bible says that He will send His fire to try everything, and everything that is not of Him will be bent in that holy fire, and everything that is of Him shall remain. So sometimes when you sense there's this type of fire blowing through your life, there's this type of wind blowing through your life, sometimes it's God just coming in to shake things up so that everything else that can remain is of Him. Hold on to that firm foundation. His name is Jesus, and He will never leave you nor forsake you. Hallelujah. We give God all His praise. And this next song is going to talk about miracles. Little miracles. So I pray you listen to the words of the song. I pray you connect with the song. And I pray that you find every little thing that God has done in your life and just say thank you to Him. That's all that song is going to do to us. And Jesus Christ likes stuff like that. Is that okay? Yeah. All right, let's go. Ask me how, 'cause I can't explain. It's nothing short of miracle I'm here. I've got some blessings that I don't deserve. I've got some scars, but just how you learn. It's nothing short of miracle you are here. I know it comes from above. I got miracles on miracles, a million little miracles. Thank you, Jesus. Miracles on miracles. Count your miracles. 1, 2, 3, 4. I can even count them all. Hope I never get over what you've done. I wanna live with an open heart. I wanna live like I know who you are. I hope I never get over what you've done for me. Ooh. I think it over.
Miracles, 1, 2, 3, 4. I can't even count them all. Miracles on miracles, a million little miracles.
Jesus.
Miracles on miracles, count your miracles. 1, 2, 3, 4. I
them all. One, two, three, four. I can't even count them all.
Lucky you, my brother.
I can't even count them all.
You and you, my father.
I can't even count them all.
Even in the devil, my sister.
I can't even count them all. One, two, three, four. I can't even count them all.
You broke my chains.
I can't even count them all.
You set me free.
I can't even count them all. I can't even count them all. One, two, three, four. I can't even count them all. I can't even count them all.
Even the times when I was struggling,
I can't even count them all. One, two, three, four. I can't even count them all. 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 One, two, three, four. I can't even count them all. 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 One, two, three, four. I can't even count them all. 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 One, two, three, four. I can't even count them all.
So, many of you, you know me, Kofi from Ghana, Africa. I don't want to paint a picture like Africa is a place that is just full of struggles, because that's not true. There's places that is blessed, skyscrapers, buildings, good education, wonderful people. However, I just want to let you know that you're looking at a living testimony. A person that a couple of years ago, I gathered my friends in high school and I said, God is going to take me places, and he's going to use me to talk about him to the nations. And they asked me, you talking about like from Kumasi to like Accra? That's like talking about Durham to Raleigh? I was like, nah. I'm talking about from Durham to like Brazil to like Cuba to like Asia. Just talking about the name of Jesus and just telling them what he's done for me. And they asked me, what has he done for you? And I said, if I tell you, I would need a whole lifetime. Because some of the things he's done in the future. And I see it. I don't experience it physically yet, but I see it in my spirit. And one of the miracles that he's done, I'm standing in it right now. I am leading people who are not from Ghana to worship one name, Jesus. So I just want you guys to picture and thank God for the miracles, the little miracles he's done for you, he's doing, and the ones that he's going to do. And thank him for that. Because God just reminded me that. I just answered one of your prayers. You're here leading people in worship, and they don't look nothing like you. This is to give God his glory, to give God his praise. And if he can do it for me, he can do it for you.
That's right.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. So if you do not mind, can I borrow your hands? You know I always say that. If you don't mind, I'll borrow your hands and just lift the name of Jesus up. That's my safe place. I'm just blessed to be walking in a miracle right now.
You called me out upon the water, the great unknown.
where feet may fail. And there I find you in the mystery, in oceans deep, my faith will stand. And I will call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours and you are mine. Oh,
look at your sons and daughters trusting you to take us back.
Your grace abounds in deepest waters. Your sovereign hand will be my guide. Where feet may fail and fear surrounds me, you've never failed and you won't start now.
Come on, sing it out, one more.
And I will call upon your name,
yeah,
and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours and you are mine. Oh,
Jesus, you are mine.
Hallelujah. Without borders, let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me, and take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, that my faith would be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me, and take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, that my faith would be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Without borders, let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me, and take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, that my faith would be made stronger in the presence of my Savior.
Thank you.
keep my eyes above the waves. My soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for every soul in this room. We thank you that we have the freedom and the privilege and the honor to come together and be a family, to be people who know that they are loved by the one and only God. And we just ask that you help us rejoice in that love, help us feel the warmth of your embrace, especially in the season that celebrates joy and celebrates Thanksgiving. You know, we ask that we truly do feel that, because sometimes it's really hard to, with everything that's going on in our personal lives, with everything that's going on in the world, it's so easy to feel the despair. And so we ask that you take away the despair, that you let us feel the emotions we need to feel, but that we remember your truth and your love and your provision. We thank you so much. There's not going to ever be words that will suffice for our gratitude, but we offer it humbly before you. Just be with the word that we hear today and let it soak into our hearts, and that we would not just keep that message in our hearts, but go out into the world and share it with others. And we ask all of this in your Son's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Good morning, Point Church.
Good morning.
Hey, my name is Grayson. I am the pastor here at Point Church Gardner. We are so glad that you are here, especially if this is your first time. One of the things we say every week, and we say it every week because we mean it, and that is that we believe church is a family. And so inside your program, you should have a little connect card, this magical little card. If you are a first-time guest with us, if you fill this out, and then you take it to a volunteer at the big blue square in the lobby that says pointing people to Jesus, if you exchange this connect card, we'd love to give you a little gift, just our way of saying thank you, because we know that getting to know any church family for the first time can be intimidating. And so the fact that you are here, we see that as a big deal, and it is an honor for us. And so please take a moment and just fill that out as much as you would like. Turn that into the big blue square, and we'd love to give you a little gift. Just, our way of saying thank you for being with us. Also on that card, if you have any other questions or next steps or prayer requests, you can also fill that out on the back. If you want more information about joining small groups or serving, or if you just have things that are burdening your heart that you would like our elders to pray for, our elders pray for those things every single Thursday. And again, it is a privilege of us to do so. And so if there's anything we can be praying for you about, just mark that on the back. You can put your name or not, doesn't matter. God knows your name. And so we just encourage you to do that. Then you can drop in the connect card bucket on your way out. A couple of other things I want to share before we continue with our service. So first of all, you know, last week, if you were here last week, you know that we kicked off something called Hope Week. Hope Week is something we do every year where we intentionally look out to our community to bring the hope of Christ through acts of service. I just want to share some of what God has done through that, and specifically through us as a church. So first of all, you know that we were collecting boxes for Operation Christmas Child. This is where we collect boxes filled with goodies that are then taken by an organization called Samaritan's Purse and shared with communities around the world who are underprivileged. And so by taking these little Christmas gifts packaged with little toys and coloring books and things like that to underprivileged communities around the world, they are also taking the gospel. And I'm excited to say that we as a church delivered 54 boxes.
Yeah.
Celebrate. Praise God. That is because of you. And for our size church, like, gosh, I was blown away. And so thank you for those of you who participated in that. Also, last week we had some people who at the school we were able to do some service projects. So we had some people come in and install some industrial shelving in one of the classrooms, which we are helping to convert into a resource room for the teachers and families and students here. One of the things I'll say a lot about this school is that about 70% of the students who come here receive free or reduced branches, which means that they come from families in need. And so by helping them to create a resource room, which we as a church can then help to stock, we're going to be able to help meet a lot of those needs. We also had a group of people out here yesterday spreading some mulch. And so if you saw in the far back parking lot or up here, we had the privilege of serving our school just by helping their campus to be a little bit nicer. So something that they didn't have to worry about, we took care of it. And so thank you for those of you who participated in that. If you signed up, we can praise God for that. If you signed up for letter writing, that is something we are still doing. And so be on the lookout for some more information about that, where we sign some letters to the staff of the school and we're planning to give them this holiday season. So putting them in their inboxes here at the school. So be on the lookout for some more information. One last thing I want to let y'all know about. So we have been, if you've been here for any amount of time at Point Church Garner, you know that last year in March, we officially became Point Church Garner, a campus of Point Church back in March of last year. And then just a few months ago, we announced that we are beginning the exciting journey of relaunching ourselves next year. Point Church is helping us to launch ourselves no longer as a campus, but as a fully independent church so that we can continue to reach our community in a unique way. So we've been working hand in hand with Point Church in that, and it's been a really exciting thing. You should have received an email, in fact, just with some more information as we continue to try to bring clarity and make sure you're all up to speed. So make sure if you didn't see that, check your email, check your spam folder. There's some more information about that. But I am excited just again to share that we are transitioning from being Point Church Garner to now Oak Community Church come January.
Yeah.
And this is, this is something that we have been working toward. Your elders and staff have been working double time for this. And so as we prepare to plant ourselves next year, still meeting here, just a new name, what you've come to know and love about Point Church Garner will stay the same, just with some new signage and new name and things like that. But I just want to let you know to be on the lookout for some more information. We are preparing for our grand opening to be January 21st next year. So in the weeks to come, we're going to have some nifty little invite cards. We're going to have yard signs and all that good stuff. So be on the lookout for that. But to help us think biblically about this thing called church planning, we are starting a new series called Think Mission. You see, when somebody accepts Christ as Savior, it is really not a question of if we are called to missions. It's only where and how. And so to help us to think biblically about what that looks like, we've actually invited Point Church's lead missionary, Chris Hankins, to come and kick off this series this morning. So in a moment, I want you to give him a warm welcome as he comes up to bring God's word. But I just want to say, listen, it is an honor to be able to do this with a family like y'all. As Kofi said, it is such a privilege, and we are excited to see what God does. So before Chris Hankins comes up here, I just want to invite you to take the next 20, 30 seconds, stand up, greet somebody around you, ask them what they're doing for Thanksgiving, and we will continue with the rest of our service in a moment.
Hi, I'm Chris.
I figured you were.
Yes, what's your name?
I'm Kathy.
Kathy?
I'm Amber.
Amber, it's very nice to meet you. Yeah, I'm excited to get to worship with y'all today.
Yeah. I like your nice warm
hands. Oh, thank you. Yeah, well, my wife says the opposite. She's like, you're too hot.
How you doing?
What's up, Kofi?
God bless.
Yeah, my man Kofi's got some warm hands, too.
Well,
yeah, we both got warm hands. We run hot, baby.
I was standing at the door, and I'm like, my fingers are all
Good morning, Point Church Garner. Morning. Guys. We are on the verge of something huge. In the next couple of months, all of our Point Church campuses will make the leap, the journey to become independent church plants. Now that's a big deal. Why do I believe that is a big deal? Because we believe with all of our hearts. In fact, I mean, I've given my life to it. That church planting is the most effective method of evangelism. That if we can work together, which is what this message is going to be all about, if we can work together to help in this process of planting Oak Community Church in January, then people will get to hear the good news of Jesus. Jesus will be proclaimed not just Sunday, not just for a couple of months, not just for a couple of years. Our prayer and belief and what we're working towards is that Jesus can be proclaimed in Garner for generations to come, for the next decades. Yes. Like, my prayer, just picture it, my prayer is that some of your grandkids and great-grandkids will come to know Jesus in Oak Community Church. That's the power of what we are about to do. And so we're laying the foundation for what I believe will be many, many people who will come to know Christ for decades to come. You know, we're actually two people away. We planted Point Church in 2010. And in the last 13 years, we've seen 998 people follow Jesus in baptism, and God is just getting started. And so the reason I say that is I'm excited to be standing here or in another building 13, 14 years from now and talking about all that God has done through Oak Community Church in that decade, those two decades, as week after week after week, this family of believers proclaim the mission of Jesus Christ, that because Jesus came, right, that we have good news, because he was Emmanuel, God with us, because he was incarnate, God in the flesh, that we have the opportunity to receive salvation, to receive a new life, to receive new purpose, to receive eternal life. And so our big idea for today is this: for us to go where God is leading, we must all be all in. For us to go where God is leading, we must all be all in. Now, how many of you like to watch TV shows, like to go to the movies, like to go see plays? Maybe you like to go see your favorite band in concert. Maybe you enjoy watching sports. I know for me, yes, Colin, yes, we love to watch college football. Next Saturday, NC State plays Carolina at NC State, and I'm still praying the Lord will provide me a ticket to this game. Come, you could be my answer to that prayer right now. My point is this, is we love to come and watch people who have practiced, right? Who have put in hours and hours of work, who have worked together to come together and do something amazing, right? Like when you go and you see that play, and somehow they've memorized like thousands and thousands of words, and they've acted to get their expressions just right, and we get to sit where you are and watch, and it's like amazing, right? We get to go on Saturday at 8 p.m. in Carter Finley Stadium, and we get to watch what they've been doing for this entire year. It reaches its culmination. They're playing at its peak, four in a row. We get to see them at their peak, right? And we get to cheer and say, yes, this was something amazing that I got to watch. However, the problem is this: so often we treat church as an event that we come and we are spectators in, right? That we treat church as an experience that we show up in and that we consume. And we go home and we're like, man, Kofi, man, he hit that part right there. Like, that was so good, that song. Like, man, they played my favorite, which they did, by the way. I told them that was some of my favorite songs today. I'm like, man, you guys really killed it on my musical preference today. Thank you. Yes. All right? And then I go home, right, and eat lunch, and then I come back next week, and I get to enjoy the experience all over again. Well, there's a problem with that idea, is that idea of church being an experience that we consume is nowhere in the Bible. See, there are several different pictures of what church is, right? It's described as a family that we're a part of. It's described as a body where each one of us plays a critical function, right? That we're all different parts of the body. We look different. We do different things. Right, but we all play an important part. This idea that we are a building, that we're living stones, where Jesus is the chief cornerstone, and we're being built up into a holy temple for God's praise. Right, now, those are very biblical ideas, right, where we are all in with this mission of Jesus and what is called the church, the body of Christ, the bride of Christ, the family of God. And our prayer is that, yes, people in Garner will see what is happening, that they will come and they will say, man, God is at work among you. And I want to be a part of this family. And so today we're going to be looking at the book of Nehemiah, one of my favorite books in the Bible. And I'm pretty much going to try to preach the whole book of the Bible. So hold on to your seats. We're going to cover the whole story of Nehemiah for sure. But my prayer is that you will see a group of people where all the people are all in for the mission of God, and the results are a beautiful thing to see. Heavenly Father, would you, God, guide us and show us how, and being a part of the family of God is one of the most amazing privileges that we could ever have, that you give us the opportunity to be a part of something so much bigger than ourselves. God, that while we are blessed through it, it is so much bigger than us, and that our community, our neighbors, our family can be blessed, that they can have the opportunity to experience the miracle of Christ in the way that you have, God, brought it to our lives, and that you have brought that joy to our heart. And so, Father God, we pray as we set off to build the foundation of Oak Community Church together, that you would be at work, that Jesus, you would be the chief cornerstone. And Father, would you help us to build well, to build together, and to build a foundation that will endure for generations to come. Father, we know we cannot do it in our strength, and so we ask right now, and I ask that you would strengthen, that you would empower us, that you would fill us with your Holy Spirit to do what we could never do on our own. And God, help us to do it together. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. All right, so Nehemiah, that's where we're going to be today. If you have your Bible, we're going to start in Nehemiah 2, but let me give you a little catch-up from the beginning of the book of Nehemiah. So the book of Nehemiah, it starts where God's people have been taken into captivity by the most powerful nation in the world. It started as Babylon, then they did a little merger, and so now they're Persia. So we're at the Persian Empire, the Persian king, right? And so they're in captivity in the most powerful nation in the world. And God has moved, right? Waymaker, God has moved, and he has made a way, just as Jeremiah prophesied, for the people to begin to come home. And so the people have begun to come home. They've moved back into their hometown, the capital of Israel, Jerusalem. But the problem is that the city is still in shambles, right? When the Babylonians came in, they knocked down the wall, they destroyed the temple, they flattened the city, and so they're basically coming back to just rubble. And also, the people who have come back, right, they are a fraction of the people who used to live in this great and grand and beautiful and powerful city. And so just imagine that they are essentially refugees coming home, and like nothing is the same. They're living in poverty. They're open to the elements. There's no wall. There's no protection. There's nothing to protect them. And so they're really in a desperate and destitute situation. And so Nehemiah, this is where Nehemiah comes in. He hears about what's going on. And so Nehemiah has been elevated to an important position of influence. I would say for such a time as this. And I believe that this is not just something that God did in Esther or in Nehemiah, but I believe he has done it in every single one of our lives, that he has put us, he has positioned us, he has placed us for such a time as this, where we are here in this community and this church family. And so Nehemiah has been put in a position of influence. He's the cupbearer to the king of Persia. So this is literally one of, if not the most trusted people, a foreigner, the most trusted people in an entire empire, right? He would taste the wine, he would taste the food before the king of Persia ate it to make sure it was not poison. And so he had access to the king. He had influence with the king. He was trusted by the king. And so Nehemiah hears about what's going on. He hears the destitute situation of the people of God and the city of God, and he is brokenhearted. Like, God rends his heart. And so he begins grieving and fasting and praying and crying out to God. And he cries and he prays and he fasts. And then he decides that he's going to take action. That he's not just going to live in luxury, right, while everyone else from the people of God are in destitute situations. But instead, he puts his career, he puts his life on the line. He goes to the king and he tells him the situation. He says, you know, the king is like, why do you look so downcast? And he's like, because my people are destitute. They're in ruin. And he's like, well, what do you want me to do for you? And he says, well, I really want to go back and to rebuild the wall around Jerusalem. And God gives him favor. God allows him to not only does the king of Persia say yes, he actually decides to fund the mission, right? He is not a follower of God, and yet this man, Nehemiah, by his actions, by his trustworthiness, he has gained favor, and he actually, the king funds the repair and the rebuilding of the wall. So Nehemiah goes back, and he talks to the people. He rides a horse around the whole city at night, and he comes in, and that's where we pick up. He's going to give the people of God a challenge. You see, I don't know if you know this, but walls don't rebuild themselves, right? There is no, like, bulldozer, right? There's no dump trucks. There's no, like cat did not exist. And so this is going to be a manual labor operation that's going to take everyone. Even though they've got the funds, it will never happen without everyone being involved. So Nehemiah chapter 2, verse 17 is where we're going to pick up the story. It says this, Nehemiah speaking, I said to them, you see the trouble we are in. Jerusalem lies in ruins and its gates have been burned with fire. Come, let us rebuild the wall of Jerusalem and we will no longer be in disgrace. I also told them about the gracious hand of my God on me and what the king has said to me. They replied, let us start rebuilding. So they began this good work. See, you are in the process where you are about to begin, I believe, one of the greatest works that you can be a part of. So they say, yes, let us start to rebuild. Now, what does this look like? This is, like I said, there's no dump trucks. What does this look like? Now, if we said, hey, let's build a building, what does that mean? Well, that means that, like, yeah, like, we're going to write a check, and then some company is going to come in, and we're going to sit in our lawn chairs, and, you know, we're going to watch them move the dirt around and say, hey, great job. This is a very different situation. Nehemiah chapter 3, verse 1, it's going to give a list of the people of God who decided to be involved in the work of God. It says, Elijah, the high priest, and his fellow priests went to work and rebuilt the sheep gate. They dedicated it and set its doors in place, building as far as the Tower of the Hundred, which they dedicated, and as far as the Tower of Hananel. The men of Jericho built the adjoining section, and Zachur, son of Imri, built next to them. The fish gate was rebuilt by the sons of Hassenah. They laid its beams and put its doors and bolts and bars in place. Meremoth, son of Uriah, the son of Hakaz, repaired the next section. Next to him, Meshullam, son of Barakai, the son of Meshabel, made repairs. And next to him, Zadok, son of Bana, also made repairs. The next section was repaired by the men of Tekoa, but their nobles would not put their shoulders to the work under their supervisors. Now, this continues for 32 verses. Now, just imagine how long that would take me pretending like I know how to pronounce all of these names, right? A lot of names. Now, I think a lot of times when we come to a section of Scripture like this, right, you read the book of Numbers or the book of Chronicles, it's like list after list after list. You're like, skip, 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 like, turn the page, skim, skim, turn the page. I don't want us to do that this morning, because I believe, one, we know that the Scripture says that all Scripture is God-breathed, useful for teaching, correcting, training, rebuking, and righteousness. So this means the list is Scripture. The list is God-breathed. The list is useful. So why did God in his wisdom, his sovereignty, decide to include these 32 verses of names in Nehemiah chapter 3? Well, let me tell you why. You see, Nehemiah wanted to record that this amazing project to rebuild the wall of Jerusalem, right? And this is not just a wall. This represents protection. This represents life. This represents flourishing. This was not done by one person. This was not done by one family. This was not done by the rich. This was not done by the poor. This was not just done by people who had experience, people who were construction workers. This took all the people being all in on the mission of God. You know, there's a rule that pastors learn when you talk about the church, when you talk about volunteering in the church, when you talk about giving to the church. It's called the 80-20 rule. All right, let me help you understand the 80-20 rule. It's very important. 80% of the work is done by 20% of the people. 80% of the funds are given by 20% of the people. Now, there are some situations where you're able to survive with that reality. This was a situation where the people of God could not rely on 80% of the work to be done by 20% of the people, or else the work of God would have never been completed. In fact, if you read, well, I don't have time to go into it this morning. If you read, everybody around them laughed at them. Like their enemies, they didn't even try to stop them. They actually laughed at them. They made fun of them. They made jokes about them, because there's no way this group of people can do this thing. But what they underestimated was what God can do when all the people are all in on the mission of God. You see, the first thing that we learn, if we're going to successfully plant the church of God here in Garner, then it's going to take everyone must contribute to the work of God. This cannot be an 80-20 church. Everyone must contribute to the work of God. When you look at these verses, a few things stand out. One, it lists who did what where. Who did what where. It said this family, right, built this section where? Right here. They built the fish gate. I don't know where the fish gate is. That sounds like a stinky place to be. I don't know. But then it lists a few extra things. It says this, verse 5, the next section was repaired by the men of Tekoa, but their nobles would not put their shoulders to the work under their supervisors. Let me translate for you. In the Greek, it says, shame on you. It doesn't really say that in the Greek, but shame on you, right? Like these nobles were actually not noble at all, because they felt like they were too good to do the work that needed to be done. You see, if we're going to see Oak Community Church successfully planted for generations to come, then everyone must be ready to do any job. Everyone must be ready to do any job. See, these men were not willing to get their hands dirty. However, that is not how the spiritual family should work. You look at who is our model, right? We just saying about Jesus. He is our model. What Jesus literally got on his hands and knees and washed the feet of his disciples. And then he said what? He said, as you have seen me do, now you should do. The way that you see me love, the way that you see me serve, the way that you see me lead, this is how you should lead, how you should serve, how you should love. And so if Jesus was willing to wash feet, right, then we must be willing to do any job that's needed. No one is exempt from the work. Verse 8, it kind of gives the opposite of the nobles of Tekoa. It says this, Uzziel, son of Hariah, one of the goldsmiths, repaired the next section. And Hananiah, one of the perfume makers, made repairs next to that. Next to him, Malchijah, one of the goldsmiths, made repairs as far as the house of the temple servants and the merchants opposite the inspection gate. So here we get a little interesting nugget, right? It not only lists who and where, but it actually lists their jobs. Now, why would it do that? Why would it list their jobs and not the jobs of everyone else? I think we all can agree that probably perfume makers are not used to doing construction work. Probably the merchants were not used to doing construction work. Probably the goldsmiths, the jewelry makers were not used to doing construction work. It started at verse 1, the priests, they were not used to doing construction work. However, this was a moment where it was all hands on deck, where everybody, the whole family of God, the people of God, needed to come together. And these people didn't say, that's beneath us. These people didn't say, well, that's not my thing. These people didn't say, well, that's not my gift. Now, I believe in serving in our gifts and serving in our strengths, but there are certain times where everyone has to come together and say, hey, give me a shovel, show me where to dig. Give me a shovel, show me where to dig. And that's what they did. They were like, hey, give me a hammer, point me where to go, right? Like, I just imagine them getting like, here's a 30-minute instruction on how to build a wall. Go for it. Learn as you go. Figure it out. I don't know. Yeah. But because the perfume makers and the goldsmiths and the merchants and the priests said, yes, here am I, use me, send me, I'll do any job because I believe in the mission of God, this wall will get built. And I believe if we have that same attitude of saying, look, kids are not my thing, making coffee's not my thing, greeting people's not my thing, opening my house is not my thing, having strangers in my home is not my thing, cooking meals for people is not my thing, but I'm going to do it anyway because of what Jesus has done for me and because I believe in the mission of planting this church here in Garner. We see it in Nehemiah 10, that the people don't just serve, they also give. 10 verse 35, the people say, we also assume responsibility for bringing to the house of the Lord each year the first fruits of our crops, and we will bring a tithe, a tenth of our crops. So we see that these people, they give an offering, and then they commit to continue to give, because it's one thing to build a wall, it's another thing to live a life. See, this was more than a one-time moment. The idea is that this was a one-time moment that was meant to facilitate, right, the people of God thriving and flourishing for generations and generations and generations to come. And the way that they did that was through something called tithing. And these people are saying, yes, we will serve, but we will also give, so that the mission of God, the worship of Yahweh, can continue, and so that he can be proclaimed to the nations, starting in this city, the city on a hill, this light to the nations. And what was the result? What was the result of these people serving tirelessly and giving generously to this mission of God? Nehemiah chapter 12, come to the end of the story. This is the wall has been complete. The enemies are dumbfounded, like they cannot believe what they're seeing, and they celebrate. Verse 43, and on that day they offered great sacrifices, rejoicing because God had given them great joy. The women and children also rejoiced. The sound of rejoicing in Jerusalem could be heard far away. See, here's what I believe. We are created to be a part of something bigger than ourselves. When all of our focus is on us, when all of our resources are focused on us, when our time is focused on us, the world says, right, that's going to make you happy. The world says that will bring you self-fulfillment, when the reality is that is so false. The more self-centered we are, the more unhappy we are. The more self-centered we are, the more we lack joy and contentment. Instead, when we seek to redirect our focus to serving God and serving others, when we are a part of something bigger than ourselves, the family of God and the mission of God, that is when we are filled with the Spirit, we experience the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, all of these things that the world is longing for, we receive. See, these people, they're not like, oh, thank goodness I don't have to do this anymore. I'm glad I can trade out, right, the hammer and get my perfume making equipment back out. No, they are like, we just got to be a part of something great. Like, I just imagine, you know, like 30 years later, those goldsmiths are like, you know, their greatest memories are not going to be the things they made out of gold. I believe their greatest memory is going to be when they built that wall. They saw God move. They saw God show up, right? You talk about a million little miracles, that wall, every single person, the fact that they even existed was a miracle of God. And I believe God, same yesterday, today, and forevermore, and I believe he wants to do that through this church. You know, even now, when I look back, one of the greatest memories, the greatest joys I have was when we had a dozen people in the living room in Cary, and we said, you know what, we're going to be all in for the mission of God to see a church planted in Raleigh. Like, I still look back at those are some of my greatest memories. Like, if I could go back there and experience that time, I would. It was unbelievable. And I believe that God has that waiting in store for this church. Nehemiah 4:6, so we rebuilt the wall till all of it reached half its height, for the people worked with all their heart. Final thing that we see is that God can accomplish anything when the people of God are all in. If we do our part, no gap will remain. The people worked together. Everyone was a contributor, not a spectator. See, God can accomplish anything when all of his people are all in. And so that's our challenge today. So there, I realize there's probably two groups of people who are here right now. So one group of people, like you are here, maybe this is your first time, your second time, your third time, and you're in, rightfully so, you're in that spectator seat where you are learning about this church, you're seeing what's happening, and you are hopefully praying, God, is this the church family that you want me to be a part of? And that is awesome. That's exactly where you should be. Then there's others of us that maybe we've been coming for 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 months, and we know, right, this is the church, this is the church family God has called us to. And if that's you, then here's my challenge. Well, let's stop being spectators, and let's commit to being contributors. Let's stop being spectators, and let's commit to being contributors. We can be all in, all together, to see God do the impossible. Everybody should have gotten one of these when you came in, all right? Hopefully you got it, yes? Just nod your head if you got one of these. Okay, so at least 5 of you got one of these. Okay, so inside of that, there's 2 cards. Okay, card number 1, this is called our Connect card. You heard my man Grayson talk about it. On the back, this is where you do need to put your name because we're not clairvoyant. All right, on the back, there's a place that says, I would like to start serving in Kid Point, Worship and Tech, Students, Guest Services, Carolina Care Center, Administration, Other. This is your chance to say, I'll pick up the hammer, give me a section of wall, I'll start building. So if you're not serving and you want to be a part of this family of God and this mission of God, I want to challenge you to fill this out and mark one of these boxes. You can mark Other and say, help me figure it out, and turn this in at the blue square outside. Second, this is our Oak Community Church commitment card. So right now, we're trying to figure out, Grayson and the elders are trying to figure out, like, what do we have to work with? Like, who's in, who's with us, so that we can budget, so that we can plan for 2024. And so here's what we want you to do. Here's our challenge. Over the next 3 weeks, take this and pray. And all we're asking you to do is this. pray about what God would have you to do. Write that down, turn it in. Just pray about what God would have you to do. Write that down and turn it in. So December 10th, we're gonna gather these cards, these commitment cards together. If you're out, we're gonna allow for December 17th as well, and then we're gonna announce it by the end of the year. This is our total commitment as a body of believers, so that we can plan and we can prepare, we can get ready for next year. So like I said, would you simply pray about what God would have you to do, write it down, turn it in. That's all we're asking. Heavenly Father, thank you for your example. God, thank you for the way that you moved through the story of Nehemiah. God, that you moved and God, you worked through this group of people that everybody thought they're too small, they're too weak, they don't have the resources, they don't have the ability. But God, thank you for moving through a group of people who were all in, all together, surrendered to you, trusting in you, empowered by you. Father, would you help us to be that same group of people? God, thank you that Oak Community Church does not depend on our strength, but on yours. But we know that you want us to do our part. You want us to be faithful. You want us to come together. You want us to serve together. You want us to give together. Father, thank you for the privilege. Thank you for the opportunity to be a part of something so much bigger than ourselves. Father, I just pray through the power of your Holy Spirit, God, that you would lay on each of our hearts what you want us to do and give us the faith to do whatever you call us to do. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Chris. You should have received also when you came in, not just a program, but also some communion. I want to invite you to take that out. And one of the things we we do every week is we take communion. We do that because it reminds us of several things. And one of the things it reminds us of is just as Chris talked about, right, God calls us to be all in, but why? Because on the cross, Jesus was all in for us. All right, Jesus gave up everything. Paul says in Philippians that he came down and he took on the form of a man, humbling himself to death, even death on the cross. The God of glory gave it all for us. And so as you take this morning, I want you to think about that. I want you to think about how he gave it all for you and what he may be calling you to do. What he may be calling you to do may not look exactly like what he's calling the person next to you to do. But maybe even I invite you to spend a moment in prayer saying, God, what do you have for me? Where are you leading? And how can I follow? As we take this meal, Jesus called us. As he sat with his disciples, he held up a piece of bread and he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you." He says, "As often as you eat this, you do so in remembrance of me." Church, may we take and eat and remember. He also held up a cup, symbolized the new covenant procured by his blood. May we take and drink in remembrance of him. As we continue in this time of response, I want to invite you, as Chris said a moment ago, not to just be spectators, but you can participate in a number of ways. Yes, through singing in worship, but also if you need prayer, myself, our elders, we would love to be able to pray with you. You can respond through, you've already responded through communion, but you can also respond this morning by giving of your tithes and offerings, whether that's through the Connect card bucket at the end of service or by going to pointchurch.com/give. But however the Lord is leading you this moment, don't leave without responding in the way that God is leading you. I invite you to stand and respond as you feel led.
The living God, we only wanna hear your voice. We're hanging on every word. Spirit of the living God. Spirit of the living God. We want to know you more and more. We're hanging on every word. Come and speak. We're hanging on every word. Spirit of the living God. Spirit of the living God. We want to know you more and more. We're hanging on every word. 'Cause when you speak, when you move, when you do what only you can do, it changes us, it changes what we see. What we seek when you come in the room, when you do what only you can do, it changes us, it changes what we see. And what we seek, it changes everything. Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, we're leaning into all you are, everything else can wait. Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, come now and breathe upon our hearts, come now and have your way. 'Cause when you speak, when you move, when you do what only you can do, it changes us, it changes what we see and what we seek. When you come in a room, when you do what only you can do, it changes us, it changes what we see and what we see. We're hanging on every word.
Point Church, thank you again for joining us this morning. Can we just express some gratitude for Chris Hankins coming out? Appreciate you, brother. Well, as he's go out today, don't forget to drop off that Connect card in our Connect card bucket. Our ushers have a nice little bucket as you walk out. Please drop those in there. If this is your first time, make sure you take that Connect card and bring it to the big blue square in the lobby. Again, we have a special gift we want to give you, just our way of saying thank you. But don't, again, as he said, don't leave just as a consumer, but be praying about how God may be calling you to participate in what he's doing here in this place. Point Church, thank you for joining us. Go out into this world and point people to Jesus. We'll see you out there.
Unsteady through emotions, I can be so up and down. I'm trying to find my focus when my mind is spinning round. Maybe I don't need to know how he's gonna work it out. Gotta put my faith in him, trusting he's at work right now.